Welcome to Asia in Review. I'm your host, Bill Sharp. My guest today is Mr. Glyn Ford. He is a former member of the European Parliament, where he was the head of the Japanese delegation and the Korea delegation. He's a frequent visitor to North Korea. In fact, he just returned from the country. He's been there over 30 times. He's also the chairman and founder of Polinit, which deals with politics, public affairs, and media consultancy. And again, as active as he is, just started another NGO called Track to Asia. He's also very active in British politics. And he is a board member of the Northeast Asia Economic Forum, which is based right here in Honolulu. Welcome to Asian Review. Again, it's good to have you back. Great. Well, North Korea, wow. When people hear North Korea, they think, wow, mysterious country. You've been there 36 times, is it?
Yep.
Wow. So obviously you have insight. How do you explain North Korea to others?
Well, I mean, it's essentially now a non-capitalist market economy, at least in Pyongyang.
A non-capitalist market economy. Okay.
If outside of Pyongyang, it's still essentially a peasant economy. Mm-hmm. The best way to think of North Korea at the moment for me is you've got three North Koreas. You've got Pyongyang, which is surrounded by a border. I mean, you have to have permission to enter Pyongyang. I mean, people try to get in there. That's where the action is. Mm. And in Pyongyang, you can buy anything you want. I mean, everything's available. There's lots of new entertainment, fun fairs, dolphinarium, indoor and outdoor water park, outdoor ice skating rink. You've also got horse riding, new theaters, new restaurants, microbreweries. People are driving around in their SUVs with their 727 number plates, 27th of July victory in the Fatherland Liberation War. That's what you would call it here in the States, the armistice. And they're smoking their 727 cigarettes. And yeah, you can buy, I saw this time, a Gucci watch for sale for $3,500 in one of the shops. So
is this, do I hear a Gangnam North being formed up here?
Yeah, I mean, so that's what you've got. Well, that's Pyongyang. Outside in the rural areas, there have been marginal improvements in the economy over the last decade, mainly because of the market opening provisions, the agricultural reforms. Initially, you know, they set lower targets for production, mm-hmm. and what you produced above the targets, you could actually sell in the farmers' markets, mm-hmm. and so that led to a reasonable boost in productivity. One of the ministers said to me, you got a better boost out of productivity with the new market reforms than you did from fertilizer. Again, they've just moved on again to the new family-sized work unit, where if you want small groups of 8 to 10 people are actually going to be evaluated on their production. And so, again, that's expected to boost productivity anew. And then the third area is what I call the Rust Belt up in the Northeast, mm. which is the big sort of industrial cities, the steel, vinylon, North Korea's own sort of synthetic textile, the cement factories. Now, up in those areas, very little is working. It's getting a little bit better, but not much is happening.
The technology is so antiquated?
No, I don't have the inputs. I mean, there's still a problem with electricity production. There's still a problem with the inputs you need in terms of raw materials and the rest. Technology does tend to be antiquated, but that's not the problem. In Pyongyang, they've got the power station, one of the two power stations, the central Pyongyang power station has been there for 60 years, so the problem in the Northeast is what you've got is you've got industry that's not really working on the coast. It's got a very narrow hinterland before you get the mountains, so there's very little production of rice and anything else up there. So that's the area where you're still having some problems, not with starvation, but with hunger. I mean, there's still problems there. And of course, this year you've got a drought. Mm-hmm. So there's no ongoing crisis at the moment. But there will be almost certainly by about June next year. They're going to be 20-30% down on production from last year from satellite pictures. This is not the North Koreans talking to me. This is the Joint Research Center in Europe looking at satellite pictures of rice paddies.
This is the Northeast is the part of North Korea that's leased out to China, essentially, isn't it?
No, that's the far Northeast.
Oh, that's the far.
You've got a section from Hamhung, Hungnam to the north, places like Chongjin and Kimchek.
Okay.
And then to the north of that, you've got a small area, well, not so small, it's the size of Singapore, mm-hmm. called Rasong, which is the Special Economic Zone. And that is fenced off. I mean, you need a passport to get in and out. And it's mainly the problem is people trying to get in rather than get out.
Mm.
And that's up on the China-Russia border.
Right.
And you've got a new Chinese motorway built in from Hunchun to Rasong, and you've got a Russian gauge railway line that's just been completed, well, 9 months ago from Rasong up to connecting up to the war's Vladivostok.
Do you see the flow of goods from Jilin province in China across North Korea to North Korean ports? Do you see any of that?
No. I mean, most of it's, where you're going to get it, there's a lot of the stuff in the marketplace is Chinese,
mm-hmm.
In terms of sort of daily necessities, toothpaste, all that kind of thing. Although there is some indigenous production, but
mm-hmm.
yeah, a lot of this is from China. But, the Northeast is really very isolated.
Mm-hmm.
Last year, I was talking to the mayor of Rasong, and he said it took him 7 days to drive to Pyongyang.
7 days?
Yeah, so nothing comes in that route. What it does, it comes across the border in Dandong. Lots of Chinese stuff comes into Rasong, but doesn't, in my view, doesn't flow much further. I've been to Rasong twice, and I'm going again at the end of August with the Northeast Asia Economic Forum. And so we're going to be having a look around there. But it's processing. Mm. What you're getting, the Chinese are subcontracting the clothing factories in Rasong to at least put together the clothes. And so they're making it's the materials brought in, it's made up and then shipped out again. And you also got this fish processing plants where you've got refrigerated Chinese lorries sort of waiting outside the plant. And as the pallets go on and as the last one goes on, the doors close and then off it drives on the Chinese motorway to Jilin.
I take it that there is no nuclear power in North Korea.
Nuclear power. I mean, the North Koreans are
developing nuclear weapons, but not nuclear power.
Well, they're talking about developing nuclear power. They've made it clear that they believe they have the right to develop nuclear power. And, of course, in a sense, the U.S. colluded in that. I mean, the 1994 framework program, which was signed between America and North Korea, was for them to stop their nuclear weapons program and nuclear research in exchange for two light water reactors
mm-hmm.
that are going to be built in North Korea, just north of Hamhung, Shimpo,
mm-hmm.
As an alternative. And the reason for light water reactors is they're proliferation resistant and also break the cycle because it required outside inputs. Whereas theoretically, if you did if you did a different kind of reactor, if you did if you used highly enriched uranium, North Korea, in theory, is self-sufficient. It's got the uranium if it has the enrichment facilities. Mm. Whereas with light water reactors, it would require an input from outside, which would give an outside agency some degree of control. But they are talking about producing nuclear power through HEU, highly enriched uranium.
Okay, now you've been to Korea 36 times, and when you go, you meet people that are very high up in the North Korean world of things. Tell us about some of the people you met.
Well, I guess the most, probably the most interesting one at the moment would be Kang Suk-ju.
Mm-hmm.
He was in New York. He was the chief negotiator in the six-party talks. He was a vice foreign minister, and he was removed about 18 months ago to be the head of the international department of the party. He's the secretary to the Central Committee. He's also a member of the Politburo, full member.
So he's standing committee.
Yeah.
Okay.
So he's one of the top dozen people in the north, and on the civilian side, one of the top half dozen.
He's also very close to the Kim family, isn't he?
I mean, the way I see North Korea, the current leadership is family and friends. I mean, at the very top.
Okay.
And so, if you're at that level, you're family or friends. Mm-hmm. He came over to Europe last September. I helped escort him around, and he visited Berlin, he visited Brussels, then Bern. In Switzerland. Mm-hmm. He was in Europe for 7-8 days. I spent a lot of time with him, traveling in the car to visit tourist sites and whatever. Mm. His favorite book is Gone with the Wind. he's a survivor. Mm-hmm. I mean, makes hard and difficult decisions, but I mean, he's very frank, he's very outspoken, you can talk to him about anything. I mean, he doesn't necessarily agree with you, but, lower down, it's more difficult. But I mean, he's got the self-confidence. And
is he ideological?
They're all ideological.
Maybe I should say, but excessively.
A lot of people, if you want lower down in the hierarchy, feel a need to constantly refer back to the leadership and the rest. After the first time I met him, we had there was a bit of that conversation, but now I know him well enough that we don't have to deal with all of that.
Mm. No, that's nice. Yeah, yeah. Cutting through that sort of thing makes things nice. Yeah.
But I mean, I've met some of the. I mean, I met Kim Jong Nam, who's the head of state. I mean, he's
very high level.
Yeah. And Choe Tae Bok, who's the Speaker of the Supreme People's Assembly. Kim Gai Kwan, he isn't anymore because they've abandoned the six-party talks, but was the six-party talks representative.
Why do they want to deal with you?
I was in the European Parliament. They came to see me trying to get food aid back in the mid-90s, and I helped deliver that, the European Union food aid. So I'm still active in the British Labour Party. They're keen on those connections. So.
Interesting. And now your track to Asia, I guess, gives you other opportunities to interact with them.
Yeah, I mean, I've got a commercial company, but let me say that none of my work with North Korea is commercial. Mm-hmm. I mean, no one's paying me to do it. It certainly opens doors. I mean,
personal interest.
Yeah. I mean, I've written a book on it. It's a bit old now, so I won't even try and advertise it. So. It was published in the States, North Korea on the Brink, also published in South Korea and Japan. Some people think well of it, others don't. A lot of the American neocons are not so keen on my book. But, I've just been on a trip with a small group, and I mean, we saw the Chinese foreign ministry in the way in and on the way out. Then we went to South Korea, saw the Minister of Unification, mm-hmm. Vice Minister of Foreign Affairs, mm-hmm. Chief Secretary in the Blue House, then to Tokyo, met the foreign affairs people, mm-hmm. met Cabinet Office, met people, the Minister for the abductee issues. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, North Korea gets you a pretty good entree anywhere.
Yeah,
I was amused. I have to say, it's self-serving, but in the Ministry of Unification, when I came out, one of the ministers' aides asked me if I'd sign a copy of my career. Why not?
Well, North Korea, is it stable?
Well, it's always a very difficult one, but yes, one's got to. If you want to stand up to be counted, it is stable in the sense I think there's very little likelihood of any change in the next decade in the regime would be my view. People in Pyongyang have never had it so good.
The picture you painted, it sounds pretty comfortable.
I mean, they're going to have a tough time, but probably not in Pyongyang in 12 months' time, but they've weathered that kind of problem before. Mm-hmm. They're desperately trying to get inward investment. I mean, they're trying to change the economy. They've tried with the Kaesong Industrial Complex, which is the one on with the south,
right.
Where but there they kind of fell out with the South Koreans, were a bit nervous. They then pushed very hard in Rasong, trying to get Chinese and trying to get any investment. I mean, anybody can invest in Rasong, but the problem is the only investment they've got at the moment is virtually entirely Chinese. They don't like being overly dependent on China. North Korea-China relations are actually quite frosty.
Right.
There's an assumption often in the States that China runs North Korea. Absolutely not.
Oh, that's not true at all. Yeah.
At the moment, they talk about a family quarrel between, but it's a bad one, between China and North Korea. So don't assume that the Chinese are in control up there. And of course, it's why Jang Song-taek got executed.
Right.
Because he was the point man with Beijing, and was considered to have exceeded his remit by leasing off large parts of Rasong, which is quite an attractive area to the Chinese, for not very much money for 50 years. So
let's come back to that point. We need to take a break here. You're watching Asia in Review. I'm your host, Bill Sharp. My guest today is Mr. Glyn Ford. He's just returned from North Korea. We're talking about that. It's a country in which he's very familiar with. He's visited it 36 times. And when he goes, he meets with people at the very highest level of the Korean political world, North Korean political world. We'll be right back. Don't go away.
Aloha. My name is PJ, and I'm the host of Hawaii Sports Update. I am very interested in local sports, and that's why I host the Hawaii Sports Update show. I bring in guests from Hawaii, I bring in guests from UH, I bring in guests from the community, I bring in big names, I bring in small names, I bring in all names that are community related and doing positive things, sports related in the community. Come join me every Tuesday at 1 p.m. here on Hawaii Sports Update. You can also join me on my golf tournament, the first annual PJ Sports Radio Show Golf Tournament. It's going to be held at Coral Creek. For any information, go to ThinkTech. Hawaii, INC, and friend us. The PayPal and a summary of the event will be right there available for you. And don't forget to tweet us.
Aloha, how you doing? I'm Gordo the Texar. Here on ThinkTech Hawaii, where we co-host Hibachi Talk, where we talk about technology and bring in all kinds of cool guests. Also, my co-host with me today is
Andrew the security guy. Thanks for watching. Thanks for watching ThinkTech Hawaii, and thanks for watching Hibachi Talk. We also have Angus.
And you there, lad? It's Angus. I bring in all kinds of wee things. Oh, look, you see my lips moving.
Welcome back to Asia in Review. I'm your host, Bill Sharp. My guest today is Mr. Glyn Ford. We're talking about North Korea, a country from which he just returned. Also, let me remind you, send us in a tweet, send us in a question. Our guest it welcomes questions, and we'd like to hear from you. Why didn't Kim Jong-un go to Moscow for the 70th anniversary? There was all kinds of expectations he was going to go.
Well, I think the trouble was Putin. He got in over his head a little bit because originally Kim Jong-un was going to go to Moscow, but then Putin got these ideas of having a North-South summit there and frankly scared away both of them. I mean, Park Geun-hye, not sure if I'm going to have a summit, we're going to have it on the Korean Peninsula, not off in Moscow, and this gets very tricky for everybody. So I think he was a bit unlucky there. The result, of course, is that means that Kim Jong-un will not be going to Beijing either.
Because if he can't go to Moscow, then he won't go to Beijing.
That's my interpretation. No one's told me.
Okay.
One of the questions was, will Kim Jong-un come to Beijing? My view is no. I mean, he's trying to improve relations with the Russians. A lot. He's making a big push with the Russians. Mm-hmm. And to not go to Moscow and then for the same event, because they're both the end of the Second World War. One's the end of the Second War in Europe, one's the end of the Second World War in Asia. I think it would be difficult for him to go. And all the signs were that he won't be going. Mm-hmm. But, I can be wrong on that, but I put money on him not going.
Okay. Well, that sounds like a response based on confidence. I hadn't heard that before. If he had gone to Moscow and if Park Geun-hye had gone to Moscow at the same time, that Putin would have been setting himself up as a kind of a peacemaker on the peninsula?
Yeah, there was talk about Putin organizing a meeting between the two of them. I think Frankly, both of them would prefer to do their own organizing about meetings. This is a very delicate issue.
Sure.
And the rest. I'm not sure Kim Jong-un, you know, he's been there a comparatively short time. I mean, he's still, I think he's firmly in control. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think the domestic issues are a priority for him over international.
Sure. Well, as long as you mention her, Park Geun-hye, let's go to the other half of the peninsula here. How do you evaluate her presidency? How do you evaluate her leadership?
I have to say I'm slightly disappointed, but that's because I had quite high expectations. I have met her in a few years ago, and I was mm-hmm. rather impressed with her. It was around the time she didn't get the presidential candidacy for the, you know, the Grand National Party. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I was rather impressed, though I was thinking there was an opportunity for a breakthrough in terms of North-South relations, but I mean, that seems to have gone out the window now. I mean, I think it's very unlikely. I mean, the North certainly don't believe her anymore. I mean, she talks about slow, gradual unification. Well, when you have slow, gradual unification, what happens? We had the Irish peace process in the UK, all the IRA terrorists got get out of jail free letters from the British government. In South Africa, when you ended what was potentially a civil war between black and white, there was a Truth and Reconciliation Commission and no one went to prison. Mm. If you're gonna have slow gradual reunification between North and South, the deal is nobody goes to prison. And if you set up a UN North Korea Human Rights Center in Seoul, you are generating lists of who's going to go to prison. Possibly rightly so. But you don't get peaceful unification without people having to accept the unacceptable and endure the unendurable. Mm. All those people in England, in Manchester, where I lived at the time when the IRA bombed, you know, people died in those bombings.
Right,
but
right.
There's no justice for them.
Right.
Because the greater justice was settling at least a 40-year-long war. It could have been, in some sense, it's going on for 100 years. Mm.
I don't follow Korea as closely as you do, but it seems to me unification in Korea will take place one day, but it'll probably be as a result of North Korea just collapsing. 20 years, 30 years down the road.
I'm not sure. I mean, firstly, the two things I would say is that the Chinese are not going to let it collapse. That's an absolute bottom line. Mm-hmm. They might want it to change. They might find ways of changing it. But for them, the notion of U.S. troops on the Yellow River is a complete no-no. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And they wouldn't trust. I mean, the Russians learned a lesson. When we enlarged the European Union into what was Central and Eastern Europe, we said, no, they won't join. Yeah, it's just the European Union. They're not going to join NATO. Mm-hmm. We're not going to deploy troops there. They have joined NATO. Isn't that an accident? Oh, by the way, we're going to put theater missile defense weapons to defend us against the Iranians in Poland.
Yeah, I know what you're saying.
So they're not going to believe that. Secondly, the North Koreans are taking a kind of, well, it's not a Chinese road, it's not a Vietnamese road, it's some kind of amalgam between the two. And if they can get that going with their, they've got Kaesong, they've got Rasong, they've got 21 other special economic zones. There's a German industrial delegation going up to Hungnam and Hamhung in October, looking at possible investment and the rest. If they get that going, they can move. They could. I mean, the South Koreans demonstrate how hardworking the population can be. North Koreans are essentially no different from South Koreans. So
right.
There's that option as well. In terms of unification, the argument would be they're very interested in the Irish peace process, because that was actually a peace process without unification.
Mm.
Now, of course, North Korea wants to unify, but they don't see it as being in the same generation as the peace process.
Mm.
They don't see the two going together, because they acknowledge that they couldn't unite on any basis of equality at the moment. And so what they would like, I'm not going to get it, In my view, what they would like is a peace process that allowed them to go off for 25 years and run an economy like China or Vietnam, and then come back in a position of much greater equality to talk about unification.
That's interesting. You know, China, it seemed that after the 18th Party Congress and the ascent of Xi Jinping to power, you got, of course, a new standing committee in the Politburo. And some of the folks on the Politburo had a lot of experience with North Korea.
I think one of them was educated there.
Yeah, Zhang Gaoli, as I recall. And they
they're still educating them now. They're still Chinese in the Kim Il-sung University.
Is that right? Actually, I've talked to scholars from Jilin University who have studied for periods of time at Kim Il-sung University. They seem to then be taking a hard line towards North Korea, sort of, and one that sort of rated this feeling, gosh, we're really fed up with you guys. But now it seems like their attitude has backed up and sort of reverted to the way it was, and it reflects a lot of what you're just saying, is like, you know, we got to keep North Korea alive, no matter what happens. Because as you're saying, you know, the U.S. Army on the Yalu River is totally unacceptable to China.
Yes, the Chinese will do whatever is necessary.
You know, in the past, there have been ideas broached that there could be an agreement between China and America. Okay, North Korea implodes. Korea is reunited, but there will be no U.S. troops north of the 38th parallel.
Well, the Chinese don't believe it. I mean, we had that with, you know, Russia. When the countries of the Russian Empire joined the European Union, mm-hmm. they were assured that we were not going to incorporate them in NATO.
Yeah.
And they've seen, you know, we're now talking about, not something I agree with personally, about Ukrainian membership of the European Union. I mean, you know.
You don't think the Ukraine should be in the European Union?
No, I don't think Ukraine should be in the European Union.
Okay. Why?
Why? I mean, I don't think it's Europe. If looking geographically, Turkey should be in before Ukraine.
Interesting. I mean,
but there's no prospects of Turkey joining, and they've been trying to get in for 30 years.
It's actually only a small part of Turkey that's really Europe, right? I mean, geographically.
I'm speaking only for myself. I mean, Ukraine's a long way away. I mean, the problem is it's the religious basis of Europe. I mean, the right wing in Europe see Europe as being, if you want Christendom, it's the Catholics and the Protestants,
mm-hmm.
And maybe the Orthodox are halfway there, but certainly not the Muslims. Mm-hmm. So it's a kind of religious approach. They see Ukraine as more part of the European Union than they do former Yugoslavia.
Mm.
For me, former Yugoslavia is more European than Ukraine.
That's interesting. I'm not quite sure how I respond to that, but that's an issue. I have to just keep that up here and turn that around a few times. A lot of Americans are not all that familiar with the European Parliament, and I probably would have to include myself in that group. Tell us about the view of the European Parliament when it comes to Asia. Generally speaking, what's the view of the European Parliament on Asia?
On Asia? Well, I mean, I was one of the people involved very heavily with Asia. I wasn't alone, but actually there's a limited interest in the European Parliament in Asia. If we look, when people are fighting for positions, we have the chairs of what we call the delegations.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the most fought over delegation is the American, the U.S. delegation. I mean, that's a big prize to get the U.S. delegation.
Mm-hmm.
Then you've got a bit of a squabble going on with the Spanish and the Portuguese about the delegation for Latin America.
Mm.
And the French are squabbling over North Africa and French Africa.
Mm-hmm.
The Brits are looking for Australia, New Zealand, Canada.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And Asia's sort of a bit left over. I mean, I remember I was on the Japanese delegation right from the beginning of back in the mid-80s, and the Japanese just could not understand why every time they got a chairman, it was an Italian communist. But it was that far down the pecking order that by then the Italian communist had a choice. So, yeah. But I mean, that's, it's changed. I mean, there was almost no interest. It's grown significantly, but it's still, compared to a lot of the rest of the world, it's a bit of a sort of backwater in terms of interest.
Let's take a break here, and then we'll come back with this and pick this up. You're watching Asia in Review. I'm your host, Bill Sharp. My guest today is Mr. Glyn Ford, a former member of the European Parliament, where he served for a number of years. Also a very frequent visitor to North Korea. And we've been talking about North Korea. And just as we break here, we're talking about the view of the European Parliament towards Asia, which is what we'll continue with when we come back in just a minute, so don't go away.
Hi, Jay.
Hi, Keith.
My name's Keith Bettinger.
I knew that.
And I'm the host of ThinkTech Asia.
I knew that, too.
Here on ThinkTech.
Fabulous. You've got a great show going, Keith.
Thank you very much. And for our viewers out there that are interested in ThinkTech Asia, it airs every Tuesday from 4 to 4:45, and it can be accessed online at thinktech.com.
Yeah, so what kind of guests you like?
Well, we have a number of guests from academia, from practitioners of international affairs. Sometimes we have military officials. Sometimes we have public officials on the show. And our goal, we try to talk about current issues in South Asia, Southeast Asia, East Asia, and Central Asia, all throughout the Asian realm, in more depth than you would find in traditional mainstream
media.
That's
the difference, isn't it?
Exactly.
That you're reaching out beyond what ordinary news media would do.
Right.
That's why we like you so much.
We're trying to provide a thinking person's perspective, an intelligent perspective on what's going on, and where both sides of the story, or even when there's more than two sides, we try to cover every angle. And I think that's one of the big benefits that we provide here at ThinkTech, is it's a really innovative source of educational programming for the people of Hawaii.
You're great, Keith. You are a great host. You got a great show going on. I watch it every week.
Thanks very much.
Why don't you guys watch it every week too, okay?
4:45 to 4 to 4:45 every Tuesday.
Welcome back to Asia in Review. I'm your host, Bill Sharp. Our guest today is Mr. Glyn Ford, a recent visitor to North Korea. And also, Mr. Ford served for a long time in the European Parliament. And just before the break, we're talking about the European Parliament and the way it views Asia and what its interest is in Asia. And let's continue from there.
Well, as I was saying before the break, I mean, the interest in Asia is rising, but it's rising from a fairly low level. China's obviously the elephant in the room. One of the big issues that's going to come up in the European Parliament in the near future is going to be market economy status. Because when China joined the WTO, we agreed that 15 years later they will get market economy status. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately for the Chinese, since then we've had the Lisbon Treaty, and the ratification of the Lisbon Treaty means that the European Parliament has the last say. And the European Parliament is actually fairly hostile to China. So China won't necessarily get market economy status. And frankly, Beijing is rather in denial about it. They keep telling us it's automatic. No, it's not automatic. It's got to be approved by the European Parliament. And the European Parliament are not necessarily going to approve it.
That's very interesting what you just said, that the European Parliament is somewhat antagonistic towards China.
There's an enormous, I mean, you've got a sort of a complex of lobbies, all of which in their own way end up creating a kind of toxic environment for China. I mean, I've got sympathy. I mean, the human rights lobby, there are still problems with human rights in China. Can't get away from it. There's the Taiwan lobby, which is there. It's a bit quieter than it has been, but somebody say it's gone away entirely. And in fact, some of the members of the European Parliament are probably more pro-Taiwan than the Taiwanese are. And then you've got the Tibet lobby. We've had the Dalai Lama several times addressing the European Parliament. And that combination can generate, if you want, resolutions on China at the drop of a hat, all of which tend to be critical.
You know, it's interesting that you say that because, you know, the things that you read in the press, it sounds like the Germans, for one, they're really going hell-bent for leather, if you know, I use that expression, and building this strategic relationship with China. And I sense that the French have a similar idea in mind.
Well, unfortunately, trade policy is made by the European Union and not by member states. So in terms of trade, Germany can do nothing, nor can France. That's a European Union competence. So any trade deals have got to be done through the European Union. And quite frankly, any other kind of relationship with China is not going to work in the absence of a trade relationship. China is very keen. They want market economy status. They're currently negotiating a bilateral investment treaty, which will also have to be approved by the European Parliament. They'd like a free trade agreement with the European Union, which frankly is not on, because you'll never be able to get the Parliament to approve it.
Wow. That's a much different picture than I get in the papers. But the papers are not always all that reliable.
Although the problem is that people haven't really woken up to the changes in this, if you want, the political architecture of the European Union post-Lisbon, because post the Lisbon Treaty, which was approved in December 2009, it's given the Parliament a lot more power, particularly over things like trade issues. Mm. So the transatlantic TTIP is going to struggle in the European Parliament. There's enormous opposition to the investor-state dispute settlement provisions. Enormous opposition to that, which is going to create big problems. But secondly, the European Parliament now effectively is the electoral college for electing the president of the European Union. The president of the Commission is elected by the European Parliament. Mm. It's the electoral college, and Merkel and Cameron both thought that they could go back to the old ways of the old smoke-filled rooms, not that anybody smokes anymore. It doesn't work like that anymore. The European Parliament selects the president on the basis of one member, one vote amongst the Parliament members.
Wow, that's very interesting. What's the view of the European Parliament vis-a-vis the TPP?
TPP, we are negotiating a free trade agreement with Japan at the moment. Mm-hmm. We've got the TTIP deal with the US. We've got a free trade agreement with Japan.
Right.
Japan is negotiating a deal with us. It's negotiating TPP along with a few others, but Japan is the big one in that deal. Interestingly, there's a complete asymmetry about these issues. In Europe, the Japan deal is a non-issue. The American deal is getting vociferous opposition. A colleague of mine is an MEP.
Does that mean the Japan deal will go through with no problem?
Well, it should do.
Okay.
Because Japan is a pussycat on ISDS. The Japanese corporations don't use these kind of provisions, okay. So they don't care. So the Japan deal should go through with no problems. The American deal will be very tough. Here in the States, actually, you quite like the deal with the European Union. There's very little opposition. Congress would have passed fast-track authority for the EU deal, I think, almost any time. It was only Obama sticking the two together to try and get the EU deal dragged TTIP through for fast-track authority. Mm. It created problems. So there's enormous opposition in the States to Japan. There's enormous opposition in Europe to the States. In Japan, again, the problem one is probably the U.S., in terms of farming and the rest. I was in Tokyo a few days ago talking to some of the negotiators about some of these issues. So it's going to be tough. It's away this week anyway, so we'll find out.
It's right here now.
Yeah, it's right here now, this day. Right. I don't know where is it?
Maui. It's on Maui.
It's on Maui, okay. Yeah.
Are you headed over that way?
I am actually going to Maui, but no, I'm not going. I didn't even know where it was.
What's the view in Europe of the U.S. rebalance to Asia?
I guess we're not surprised. I mean, you have to bear in mind, I come from a particular set of politics. I was a Labour member of the European Parliament. I was a candidate in last year's European elections. I didn't get elected, but I was one place off getting re-elected.
That hurts.
But anyway, all I'm saying is your viewers need to bear that in mind. But I mean, in many senses, it will be seen as an attempt to, if you want, isolate China. Mm-hmm. That's how we would see it. I mean, I'd love to know which bit of the Pacific Vietnam's on.
Uh, I'm not sure I understood that comment, though.
Well, fine. The Trans-Pacific Partnership, Vietnam's in the negotiation.
Okay.
So one assumes that Vietnam's Pacific on the Pacific.
Pacific Rim. Any country of the Pacific Rim. Well, Peru's in there, too. Mexico's in there.
Well, they're on the Pacific, Peru, yeah. Mexico. I'm not sure that Vietnam is.
Yeah,
but anyway, I mean, we would see it. I mean, what's going to be interesting this week for me mm-hmm. is what the more economic and trade concessions the U.S. makes to get the deal done, the more it's about a strategic encircling of China, and the less concessions it makes, the more it's actually about trade. I think that will be the test. The test is how desperate does the U.S. want it? What's it prepared to give up to get it? And if it's more interested, if the politics play a much bigger role than it is commonly announced in Washington, then there will be trade concessions to get the politics right.
So is it going to happen? What's your prediction?
My prediction would be yes. I think it's going to happen in the sense of you signing something. Mm-hmm. Whether it's going to go through Congress, not so sure. Mm. Partly depends on the presidential election. If you get, if Clinton wins, it may go through because mm-hmm. the Republicans will put it, will pass it. But mm-hmm. If you end up with a Democratic majority, because it's not going to be going through for a couple of years, if you end up with a Democratic majority after you get a Republican president in the Senate or the House, then it could struggle.
Okay. Well, we're coming down to our last 3 minutes or so, and yes, this show is called Asian Review, but since you're so deeply involved with British politics, tell us a little bit about some of the recent activity in the British political world. Now, I, for one, from my observation post here in the mid-Pacific, way far away from the UK, was surprised that the, is it fair to say, the drubbing that the Labour Party suffered in Scotland. Why is that? Why did the Labour Party fall apart so?
Well, I mean, two things. The Labour Party still got a lot of votes in Scotland. We're the second party by far. Mm-hmm. If it had been proportional representation, it wouldn't have been too bad, but you live and die by the first-past-the-post system, mm-hmm. like you do in the States. Mm-hmm. The big mistake in Scotland was over the referendum, in my view. There was a referendum for Scottish independence,
right.
and the mistake that we did, and I did argue at the time to a degree, was that we actually did a combined campaign against Scottish nationalists with the Liberals, the Conservatives, and Labour. And we got labelled as red Tories, because the people in Scotland really don't like. One of the drives for independence was whoever they vote for in Scotland, they get a Tory government. And so we were labelled as red Tories, and that hit us very badly. And that's one of the issues that's going to be coming up in terms of the referendum. We're currently electing a new leader of the Labour Party. Don't know who it's going to be till September the 12th. But I mean, one of the big issues is going to be how do we campaign against leaving the European Union. And if we do this happy clappy Tory Labour Liberal campaign, then I think we're going to also suffer. We need to do our own campaign. We need to be arguing for our Europe, not theirs, which is why I edited a book with that title 12 months ago. I mean, we need to be making the case to Labour voters why to stay in, not making the Tory case for staying in. We like the fact that Europe gives high levels of social protection, maternity leave, paternity leave, and the rest.
We're down to 1 minute.
What we don't like is if you want the Tories wanting to weaken all of those things in exchange for, if you want, for keep staying in. We should do the Captain Oates approach. He was the famous British explorer who went off to buy a newspaper, who walked out to die in the snow to allow his comrades to live. It's better for us to leave the European Union than to destroy the European Union by undermining its social values by having a Tory European Union.
Wow. Well, thank you very much for being with us today, and thank you very much for watching out there. You've been watching Asian Review. I'm your host, Phil Sharp. Our guest today has been Mr. Glyn Ford. He's given us a lot of things to think about on North Korea, and just the last few minutes, some insight into British politics. We'll be back here next week, and we hope to see you then. Same place, same time. Have a good day.